Well, hello! It sure is nice to see all of you. Obviously, I can't see you, but now you can see me. Today's poem is going to be Fever 103 by Sylvia Plath. And we're about to listen to her read her own version of it. And then we will break it down, provide an analysis of it. And we're going to do it in a rather unique way by just connecting it to our course, things that we've read and themes that we have been exploring. So, please enjoy Sylvia Plath, Fever 103.
Fever 103. Pure, what does it mean? The tongues of hell are dull, dull as the triple tongues of dull, fat Cerberus who wheezes at the gate. Incapable of licking clean the ague tendon, the sin, the sin. The tinder cries, the indelible smell of a snuffed candle. Love, love, the low smokes roll from me like Isadora's scarves. I'm in a fright one scarf will catch an anchor in the wheel. Such yellow sullen smokes make their own element. They will not rise, but trundle round the globe, choking the aged and the meek, the weak hothouse baby in its crib, the ghastly orchid hanging its hanging garden in the air. Devilish leopard, radiation turned it white and killed it in an hour. Greasing the bodies of adulterers like Hiroshima ash and eating in the sin, the sin. Darling, all night I have been flickering off, on, off, on. The sheets grow heavy as a lecher's kiss. 3 days, 3 nights. Lemon water, chicken water, water make me rich. I am too pure for you or anyone. Your body hurts me as the world hurts God. I am a lantern. My head the moon of Japanese paper, my gold-beaten skin infinitely delicate and infinitely expensive. Does not my heat astound you, and my light? All by myself I am a huge camellia, glowing and coming and going, flush on flush. I think I am going up, I think I may rise. The beads of hot metal fly, and I, love, I am a pure acetylene virgin, attended by roses, by kisses, by cherubim, by whatever these pink things mean, not you, nor him, nor him, nor him, my cells dissolving old whore petticoats to paradise.
Never know how much I love you, never know how much I care, when you put your arms around me, I get a fever that's so hard to bear. You give me fever.
That was Peggy Lee with Fever. We're here today to talk about Sylvia Plath's remarkable 1962 poem, Fever 103 Degrees. On the surface, it is about having a fever. I hope, though, to put it into dialogue with the other texts that we've been reading this year and maybe raise some questions about how a poem can work and what ideas resonate when different authors are thinking about the same material. So let's get started. These, by the way, are my annotations in preparation for this little lecture. So Sylvia Plath opens, and I want you to just look at the structure. Notice it's all of these three-line stanzas. And there's not a very clear rhyme scheme, but I want you to notice A, B, C, D, C, A, E, F, A. So you see we get these repeated rhymes, but they're not as carefully patterned. However, when you think about rhymes interlocking and three-line stanzas, it should scream to you, Dante, right? This is the terza rima idea. P pure. What does it mean? We have these two questions. The poem is going to really investigate this idea of pureness. The tongues of hell are dull. Dull as the triple tongues of dull, fat Cerberus who wheezes at the gate. Incapable of licking clean the eggy tendon. The sin, the tinder cries, the indelible smell. So I want to point to a couple of things here. In particular, notice the triple repetition of dull, 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 right? Repetition acts to deaden and dull the tongues themselves. Cerberus is fat, and this is not the first time we've encountered Cerberus, right? The famed three-headed dog that guards the underworld. We've seen him both in the Aeneid. Will you remember Aeneas got by with the soporific cake? And we also saw Cerberus in the Inferno. And now we have this fever poem by Plath with opens at the gates of hell with Cerberus. But this Cerberus doesn't seem very threatening because he's wheezing and incapable of licking clean. So I know Darius might want to make a connection to the filth that is there in the Inferno. Sonically, look at all of those ins. In is buildup of sound just pulsing throughout the poem. It's almost like a headache that's there. So immediately what I want to suggest is that we're opening in the world of the underworld, right? This is hell. And what the poem is going to do is make us ascend. We're going to move increasingly upward in a way that kind of mimics Dante. And we're going to do it with a triple repetition of pure. So this is our first moment of pure, and I want to suggest this is going to be hell, the Inferno. We have the introduction of this idea of flame here with tinder. So we're going to pick that up now, and this is, you know, the flames of hell. Except it's the indelible smell of a snuffed candle, right? The candle has gone out. It's no longer flame. Love, love, the low smokes roll from me like Isadora's scarves. I'm in a fright. One scarf will catch an anchor in the wheel. Such yellow, sullen smokes make their own element. They will not rise, but trundle round the globe, choking the aged and the meek, the weak. Hothouse baby in its crib, the ghastly orchid, hanging its hanging garden in the air. So there's a few sonic elements as well. Notice this extreme enjambment where we have the low smokes roll from me. I'm in a fright. One scarf will catch, right? It's almost as though that scarf is floating down across the lines. So a couple things to just contextualize this. We start with a historical allusion of Isadora Duncan, who is a very famous mid-century dancer. And she died in France when she was in a convertible and her scarf went flying in the wind and it got caught in the rear wheel and she was strangled to death. And so this is the elaborate metaphor that Sylvia Plath has constructed. This idea that we go from the smoke of the blown out candle flowing like the scarf. And then she's paranoid, the speaker is paranoid, that one scarf will catch an anchor in the wheel. And notice this like catch, this idea of catch fire, but then also catch and latch on. With the line, such yellow sullen smokes make their own element, we have almost alchemical experience, but a yellow smoke is also kind of a reference to sulfur, and sulfur is the smell of hell, which we've talked about a couple of times already. Taking that idea of the snuffed candle and this next line of trundle around the globe, I wonder if you guys hear, like I do, a literary allusion to Macbeth. The snuffed candle would refer to the out-out brief candle of Macbeth's famous tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow soliloquy, while Trundle round the globe kind of imitates, creeps in this petty place, poor player that struts and frets his hour on the stage, right? You'll remember that the globe was the name of Shakespeare's theater, and so we get that meta-theatrical reference. Turning this speaker into somebody that has as much an internal conflict as Macbeth, right? Is life structured around a series of prophecies, or is there independence? Choking the aged and the meek, the weak, right? These very strong rhymes that serve to yoke the people that are not the Macbeths of the world, right? This is a very, Macbeth would kill anybody that is not powerful. And we then have these kind of last three lines that develop the horticultural metaphor, maybe like a hothouse baby in its crib. And with that, I hear, just because I happened to read it recently with you all, when the reference of the crib, I hear maybe Yeats's rocking cradle from which the beast emerged. Orchids are usually known for being very beautiful, so call it ghastly. And then it hangs, right? So that picks up that language from the scarf catching. And then we have this idea of hanging. And we also have an allusion here to the Hanging Gardens of Babylon, which places us in a deep, deep historicity, right? Like this bas relief is from Ashurbanipal's palace, which is also where you have the most surviving tablets of the cuneiform tablets of Gilgamesh. So there's this idea of culture that's built into all of this imagery of destruction. Devilish leopard, radiation turned it white and killed it in an hour, greasing the bodies of adulterers like Hiroshima ash and eating in the sin, the sin. Darling, all night I have been flickering off and on, off and on. The sheets grow heavy as a lecher's kiss. 3 days, 3 nights. Lemon water, chicken water, water makes me wretch. So the devilish leopard, people have pointed to being a reference to the leopard or panther at the beginning of Dante's Inferno. That kind of blocks Dante from escaping and forces him to descend, the leopard having an association with sexuality. And these four stanzas in particular are deeply, deeply rooted in sex. And I'll be arguing in a second, specifically masturbation. The leopard, who's known for its spots, is turned white by radiation. So here we enter our realm of the historical illusion. We have the atomic fallout, and that radiation is picking up on the earlier image of the sullen smoke being a different element. And it killed it in an hour, right? So that beast that forced Dante on his journey is now dead. And I would like to suggest that Sylvia Plath might be making a comment about if art is possible after this point, right? After the atomic bomb, we seem to have lost the world of the sacred and the spiritual. We've shifted away from that, and Plath is trying to figure out what that world looks like. And Hiroshima, the reference to Japan, we're gonna pick that up in a second as well. Now though, Plath makes kind of a shift. She uses what's called apostrophe to address somebody that's not there in the poem, this darling. The darling is not there. And the speaker says, all night I have been flickering off, on, off, on. And one way of understanding this is that it's a reference to masturbation, female masturbation, this idea of flicking. And then the sheets are growing heavy as a lecher's kiss because of this idea of like sexual gluttony in a lecher, which fits to the language of consumption, specifically oral consumption here in Eating In. And all of that picks up this language of leopard lust and adulterers and sin. The thing though is, does the speaker of this poem actually find it to be sinful? Along with this fever, we get just iteration and tiredness. 3 days, 3 nights, lemon water, chicken water. That's a really great joke. Chicken water is soup, but it's like she forces this use of water 3 times. And whenever you, there's only one reference that water refers to, and it should call immediately to anybody's mind Coleridge's Rhyme of the Ancient Mariner, another great long ballad about the confrontation with death and surviving and what does it mean to keep living. And in that poem, he writes, "There's a mariner that has returned home, and he's saying about the ocean, water, water everywhere, nor any drop to drink." And now this kind of chicken water is the kind of water that's making this speaker wretch, right? That water should be the substance of rejuvenation and life, but instead it's destructive and makes them wretch. And it doesn't provide purification, which brings us to the next line. "I am too pure for you or anyone. Your body hurts me as the world hurts God. I am a lantern." So I think with this line, "I am too pure," we're making our shift into part, we're completing our shift to part two. I think part two actually began on the line, "Darling, all night," right? When we shifted to the personal of the bedroom. And now I think we have this use of pure in part two, which is helping concentrate that. "So I'm too pure for you or anyone." Who is this you? Well, it seems to be the darling. And she's redefining her pureness, right? Your body, she says, hurts me as the world hurts God, which, if you follow that parallelism, makes her a god itself. The reference to the world hurting God, the kind of violent nature of religious iconography and language, I see some echoes of John Donne's "Batter My Heart," three-personed God. So let's see, what do we have? We have perhaps that literary allusion, which is not strong, but I really want to emphasize what we have here are eschatological narratives. You'll remember in the text that we read, whether it was Genesis or Winnebudzu or even Gilgamesh, when the world hurt God, God hurt the world. He destroyed it. You'll remember eschatological is a word we use to refer to the end of the world, the study of the end of the world. And that's what this fever does, this burning. She continues, "I am a lantern," right? The light is returned. We had the snuffed candle, but now we have a lantern. "My head a moon of Japanese paper, my gold beaten skin, infinitely delicate and infinitely expensive." This is problematic. It's orientalizing. She's othering herself and yoking herself to Japan, which we just had the conversation about Hiroshima. So there's a lot that's going on there that is, this is kind of more the problematics that would be really interesting to unpack, but I'm not going to be doing that in this particular lecture. What I do want to focus on is what kind of lantern this might be, and I want to suggest that it's a Japanese paper lantern where you put a candle inside and it rises. And you'll notice in that fourth stanza here on this page, "I think I am going up, I think I may rise." And that's because after God and "I am a lantern," I think this is where part three of the poem is, this emergence into paradise. "Does not my heat astound you," right? We have that relit lantern with light. And she continues a new metaphor, "I am a huge camellia," which is a lush flower, glowing and coming and going, flush on flush. This is another line that you could support an argument about this being a celebration of female sexuality, and specifically almost autoerotic sexuality. "I think I am going up, I think I may rise, the beads of hot metal fly," and I love "I." Beads of hot metal, kind of three different ideas come to mind. Bullets, which I don't think gets you very far. Mercury, that's inside of a thermometer, which I think is very literal. And I think you might also be able to argue for it being beads of sweat. Specifically, you'll remember, like, if we're thinking of the different ways that substances are transforming into other substances. I don't know how far that's going to get us, though. We continue our ascent with the next stanzas. "I am a pure acetylene, virgin, attended by roses, by kisses, by cherubim, by whatever these pink things mean. Not you, nor him, nor him, nor him. Myself's dissolving, old whore petticoats, to paradise." So when she says she's pure acetylene, right, that's an unstable, flammable gas. So she's moved between these different stages. She's no longer even a body. Calling herself a virgin attended by roses is putting us in the religious iconography of the Virgin Mary with the kisses and the cherubim. Cherubim are tiny angels, like baby angels. And then this phenomenal line, by whatever these pink things mean. You'll remember from my lecture on The Second Coming by Yeats, things in poems are so rich and get you really far because it's that utter lack of specificity. Like, what in the world is a pink thing? Is it a rose? Is it a kiss? Is it cherubim's, like, little cuteness and pudginess? What is the thingness of this poem? Things fall apart. So things are dangerous. And then not you is not you, darling, like the lover, nor him, probably God, nor him, right? Nor him. This is the utter rejection of the patriarchy, right? None of these masculine pronouns are something that she's going to have to get to paradise. And we kind of have this genius use of punctuation here in the second to last line, the penultimate line, where she hides herself. Even as she says herself is dissolving, old whore petticoats, she's making it compact by using those parentheses. She's protecting who herself is, even in its act of dissolving, as it, you know, floats, rises perhaps towards paradise in this gaseous state. Old whore petticoats probably connects to the reference to the camellia earlier, which might be a reference to a French story, La Dame aux Camélias, which is about a prostitute. And then the last word, right? Paradise. So we start with pure and we end at paradise. So we've moved from hell to the body and now to paradise. And so however you might define that paradise, right? I think that's what becomes quite difficult. So I hope this has been an enjoyable poem and experience for you. I find it just extraordinary and rich. So I would like to have you guys respond to two different reflection options on the forum that I'm going to post. The first one is a critical. What are some words or phrases that stand out to you and why did they resonate? Right? So just more of a, maybe not critical, but reactionary. And this one is getting you to think. Do you think that the care with which this poem is written increases or decreases the representation of a fevered consciousness? Right? Are you capable of describing this kind of transcendental experience in an accurate way if you are fevered or not? So I hope that maybe you can explore some other Sylvia Plath. But for now...
Guess what? I got a fever! And the only prescription...